to go to Mercy City. I will entreat you just to go there and receive exactly what the Lord has for you. I came with the grace of God. I came with the presence of God. I came with the blessings of the Holy Ghost. I came with another level after the impartation, after the ordination from this very great man of God, in the person of Senior Prophet Jeremiah Motufofi. I just want to let each and every one of you to know the level have changed. God has moved us to another level because we really, can you imagine, every day we have two services for almost 4 days. You know, started on 10th, 11th, 12th, 13th, and 14th. You find out that every day, we have this wonderful two services. That was an experience that many of us have never experienced. So, I am back home here in the city of Hamburg, Germany. And from now to the end of the year, I'm going to be around in Hamburg. Our schedule starts for the traveling and things like that next year, but this year I'm at home. So Sunday is going to be a special Sunday. That is a Sunday to appreciate what God is doing through the servant of God. That is a time to show kindness. It's a time to show love. It's a time that the Bible spoke about in Matthew chapter 10, verse 41 and 42. The Bible says, whosoever that giveth a cup of water to the prophet, he received the prophet's reward. So it's going to be a father's blessing on coming Sunday, being the 22nd of this very month of December. So be my guest. Anywhere you are, I want you to be my guest so that we can celebrate together. You know, whether you have got something to bless the man of God or not, I want to see you. I carry the spiritual blessing to bless you. You know, the Bible spoke about when you bless the man of God physically, he will bless you spiritually. And I tell you, the spiritual blessing is more than the physical blessings, although we need it too. So you carry the physical blessing, I carry the spiritual blessings. So I want to see each and every one of you. I tell you, it's so awesome. It's so awesome. The kind of the teachings we have received, the kind of impartation we have received, you know, we climbed the mountain of Carmel, you know, we climbed to Mount Carmel, and that is where situations and issues are being handled. It's a place of challenge where you can challenge God and challenge every power that have been working against your sources. It's a place that God have deposited his presence. You know, the presence of God is almost everywhere, but there is a place that the presence of God is more active than other places. When you go into the mountain, that is a place of settlement. It's a place you are left alone. I mean, a place where you can now talk to God. Oh, I really felt when I was, before I came out this very evening, I really felt something. You know, we have no mountain in Europe. Where is the mountain where people can just go? I was just thinking about this. You know, when you go to Africa, almost every big churches, they have this very mountain where people can just go and prostrate before God. Where people can just go and have one-on-one with God. Where people can go and bring their supplications to God. Where people can go and relax in the presence of God. This is what we are missing in Europe. This is exactly what we are missing in Europe. And I was telling God, I said, God, help me. I need a mountain where people can come from every part of the world just to have just to relax in your presence. I mean, just to have a place to just separate themselves, you know, so that they can be able to have a personal and interwoven relationship with you, you know. So we need a mountain in Europe. We need a mountain in Europe. This is a place where people just begin to, challenge whatsoever that have been challenging them. You know, it's a place of war. It's a place that God wants you to bring up your voice up so that you can receive immediately, you know, what belongs to you. It's a place of transfiguration. And these are the things we have been missing in Europe. So my heart was crying. And I believe in God by His grace that He's going to give us a mountain where people can go and be able to just relax in the presence of God just is a personal place. It's one-on-one. It's like a secret place where you can just relate with the presence of God, relate with the Holy Ghost. I know you can pray everywhere. I know you can pray anywhere also. But one thing is that when God asks us to go to the mountain, we find there is some things He wants to reveal to us. It's a place where God revealed a lot of things to us. You know, why did Jesus Christ went to the mountain? Why did Jesus Christ went to the mountain? The Bible said some of the times He will send disciples away and He goes to the mountain. You know, if Jesus Christ can go to the mountain, brothers and sisters, we can go to millions of mountains. But if Jesus found going to mountain very, very important. If we are not going to the mountain, it means there is something that we are missing. It means there is something that we are missing. I'll tell you, it means there is a great deal of a thing that we are missing. Because if the only begotten Son of God took time to go to the mountain to go and communicate with the Father, I believe that we need a mountain in Europe. And we're going to pray together tonight that God will give us a mountain. Moses went to the mountain. Abraham went to the mountain. You must know in the book of 1 Kings chapter 18, you know, Elijah was running away from Ahab. He was running away from Jezebel. He was running away from people who had been chasing him to deal with him. But one day he summoned courage and he said, please, let's go to the mountain. And they went to the Mount Carmel. And that is a place of decision. That is a place of confrontation. That is a place whereby God tested the power to know who is that man that can challenge him. You know, so I really want you to pray for me. I need God to give me a mountain because my heart is longing for a mountain. My heart is crying for a mountain where people can come from every part of the world, at least have a good time to receive what God has for them. So what am I saying? It was on this very mountain of Carmel that Elijah and the prophet of Baal was able to settle issues that have been longing, the challenges that have been longing, the situation that have been longing. That is a place of settlement. You must remember in the land of Moriah, that is when God spoke to Abraham and said, Abraham, I want you to go to the land of Moriah. Then I'm going to show you the mountain where you're going to sacrifice your only son, Isaac. And Abraham summoned courage. Can you imagine? Summoned the courage to go to the land of Moriah. The Bible said while he was just going, almost reaching to the place, he lifted up his eyes and he found this very mountain. You know, God did not explain the name of that very mountain, which means mountain is very, very important. We can have mountains. We can have mountains. So I am strictly believing God that God is going to give me a mountain whereby people can come and have a very good time with the Lord. Remember that God commanded that Cain and Abel should bring a sacrifice. It's a place of sacrifice. Mountain is a place of sacrifice. The Bible spoke about Jesus Christ, the Lamb that was slain right from the foundation of the world. It's a place of sacrifice. What do I mean? It's a place that God wants to test the faith of a man to know whether what you are speaking from your mouth is the same thing you are speaking from your heart. That is a place God tests people. It's where He takes His people to know whether they really love Him, whether they know, whether they really have a part in Him. So now, God decided to sacrifice His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ of Nazareth. The Bible said it's the Lamb that was sacrificed. So what am I telling you tonight? Mountain is a place of sacrifice. It's a place that God wants to know whether you are a giver or you are a withholder. Are you listening to me? Whether, because the Bible said that God so much loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. Are you listening to me? So it's a place that God wants to test you whether you are a giver or a withholder. And if you happen to be a giver, brothers and sisters, the mountain will speak on your behalf. That was the point in time Jesus Christ took three of his disciples to the mountain. And the Bible says, while they were at the mountain, the anointing of the Holy Ghost flew all over the place. The presence of God was all over the place. And Peter said, Master, there is no need for us to go down. from this very mountain. Let's remain in this very mountain and build three tabernacles, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. So it's a place of transfiguration. It's a place of change. It's a place that God changes your situation very, very quickly. So we need a mountain. We need a mountain whereby people will come from every part of the world and be able to have a good time with the presence of God. What am I talking about tonight? What am I talking about tonight? It's a place that God revenge on the behalf of his children. It's a place that God hold his peace. Hold his peace. We hold our peace to fight a battle for us. It's a place that he hold our peace to fight a battle for us. You might remember, there's a place that Moses was able to contact God. The Bible said he goes to the mountain. One of the days he went to the mountain Sinai. So mountain is very, very important in our lives. Mountain is very, very important. So I am believing God that God is going to give us a mountain whereby we can be able to cry to him and he will hear us. God can hear us anywhere and everywhere we call him. But there are specific places that God has instructed us to be so that we can be able to just be left alone, so that we can be able to come in with him, because God is a jealous God. Tonight, I want to entreat you with what I have really entitled, you need a mountain. I need a mountain, you need a mountain, and I need a mountain. That is what I want to share with you tonight. Every one of us need a mountain. You know, we need that very mountain because it's like a point of, it's like a medium of communication. It's like a medium of settlement. It's like a medium whereby God hears our supplication, whereby we sacrifice unto God, where we bring our sacrifices unto God. You know, one thing is that man can pray, but when it comes to the sacrifices, when it comes to the giving, that's what I'm talking about. When it comes to the giving, most of the times we cannot be able to give. We cannot be able to give. But it's a place that God tests us whether we are givers or not. So I want to entreat each and every one of you tonight. I just came down from this very mountain. I tell you, I was able to go to the mountain of power. I was able to go to the mountain of favor. I was able to go to the mountain of mercy. I want to tell each and every one of you, you need to climb any of the mountains. What do I mean? You need to be in the mountain so that the freshness of the presence of God will be able to deliver you without struggle. It's a place that God stands on behalf of his people. It's a place that God stands to deal with the works of the enemy. What am I talking about? If there is a mountain of God, there is a mountain of the devil. I want to tell you this. The demons have a mountain. Witches have a mountain. Wizards have a mountain. The Bible says something that some trusted in chariots, some trusted in horses. What is that Bible? What is that quotation implies to us? What is God talking to us there? That some trusted in chariots and some trusted in horses. What is he talking to us? You know, you cannot trust in a chariot without having a mountain. And you cannot trust in a horses without having a mountain. You know, so these are the worldly men God is trying to let us know. They trusted in their evil mountains. But I want to let each and every one of you to know that it's a mountain where the presence of God dwells. You need that very mountain in your life. You need it. You know, many believers in Europe, their spirituality is not so strong. And that is why nobody is trying to have a mountain whereby God can remember us very quickly, whereby others can be a recipient of this very grace. You know, we have visited a lot of recreations, just like these very holidays. Christmas holidays is coming up. People are planning how they can go to this place or that place or that place. Nobody is planning to go to the mountain. Nobody. Nobody is planning to go to the mountain. But in Africa, many people are planning just to be in the mountain to communicate with God, to table their issues with God, so that by the next year, they have already put in their skirt and their plans before God. So I want to let each and every one of you to know, you need a mountain, and I need a mountain. So we're going to believe God to give us a mountain whereby we can be able to function to the brim, whereby we can be able to function to the brim. I want to tell you something tonight. I want to take you to the book of Zechariah chapter 4 and verse 7. Zechariah chapter 4 and verse 7. We're going to read it together tonight, and I will explain to you that you need a mountain. You know, when Paul speaks about a mountain, he talks about two things. Mante can represent problems, and Mante can be a place to fight the problems. Can I say that again? Mountains can represent problems, and Mante can be also a place to fight the problems. We witnessed that Mante can be in a problem when the Bible spoke about Mark chapter 11 from verse 2 to 3. The Bible said you can speak to the mountains and they can be removed. Okay? And the mountain can also be a place of settlement, like I told you in the book of 1 Kings chapter 18. So let me show you something tonight in the book of Zechariah chapter 4 and verse 7. Come along with me. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Father, we give you the glory. Libros katuba shan tolima likrobos kete. Leko tobros kiman tolimas kibos ketanta. Pakoli bros kiben telimanda. Sheko lobo likatako tuanda. Sabo kamos kibos kete. Libros sikate. Zechariah chapter 4 and verse 7. The Bible says, "Who art thou, O great mountain? Before Zerubbabel, thou shalt become a plain, and he shall bring forth the headstone thereof, with shouting, crying, grace, grace unto it." Shouting, grace, grace unto it. But there is something that has underscored there. "Who art thou, O great mountain? Before Zerubbabel, thou shalt become a plain." Your mountain of problems shall become a plain. Your mountain of troubles shall become a plain. Your mountain of challenges shall become a plain. In the name of Jesus. And he went further to say, "And they shall bring forth the headstone thereof, with shouting, crying, grace, grace unto it." Praise the Lord. Let's see Matthew chapter 14 and verse 23 and 24. Matthew chapter 14, verse 23 and 24. Thank you, Holy Spirit of God. What a wonderful experience in Mercy City. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Matthew chapter 14, verse 23 and 24. The Bible says, "And when he had sent the disciples away, he went up into the mountain apart to pray. And when the evening was come, he was there alone. But the ship was now at the midst of the sea, tossed with waves, for the wind was contrary." Oh my goodness. Oh my goodness. I'm going to take this very reflection very, very easy. Listen to me. We are all over the world and everybody listening to me here. The Bible says there was a problem. The mountain was a problem. Zerubbabel said the mountain was a problem. And he said, "Who is this very mountain standing before Zerubbabel? What kind of mountain standing before Zerubbabel? What kind of mountain is that standing before Zerubbabel?" The Bible said, "It shall be made plain." And here we are reading another scripture, which means in the time of the Zerubbabel, that mountain was challenges and situations. That mountain were troubles. That mountain were challenges. And he said, "You're going to be plain." What is it? You're going to level that very mountain of challenges. And in the time of Jesus, we are reading something here in Matthew chapter 14, from verse 23 and 24. The Bible says something here. "And when he has sent the disciples away, he went into a mountain apart to pray. And when the evening was come, he was there alone." He was there alone. When the evening came, Jesus was left alone. And he began to communicate with the Father. He began to pray to the Father. Brothers and sisters, you know, when you go into the mountain, your needs must be met. But the enemy can never be happy. You know, I want to say that again. When you go into the mountain, when you go to the mountain to pray, your needs must be met. God is going to hear you. But because you have contacted heaven, because you have contacted God concerning your situation, the enemy will never be happy. But forget about that. God has already given you victory over that very demonic power while you are at the mountain. God has given you victory over that very enemy while you are at the mountain. That is what the verse 24 said. "But the ship was now at the midst of the sea, tossed with waves, for the wind was contrary." Can you imagine? Jesus went to the mountain, and when he was coming down, now he was in the sea, and the wind began to blow very boisterously. Begin to blow, you know, and can you imagine? Because he had gone to contact the God, the enemy was not happy. Because he had gone to contact God, his request meant the enemy was not happy. So don't ever focus on the enemy. But I want you to focus on the reason why you went to the mountain. Mountain is a place of joy, it's a place of peace, it's a place we receive direction. You know, it's a place we receive the knowledge of God. It's a place we receive the transformation. It's a place we receive the wisdom to know what to do to the next level, the next time. It's a place we contact the presence of God. We hear God. It's a place we hear God. So I entreat each and every one of you, you've got to get into the mountain. You're gonna go to the mountain to receive what God has for you. I want to say this again, something on this very verse 23. And when he had sent the disciples, the multitude away, he sent them away, and he went to refresh himself. It's a place of refreshment. It's a place to refresh the presence of God. It's a place. It's like. When you see that the plane, let me just give an example. The plane took off from Hamburg and it landed to Frankfurt or to München or just to any part of the world. Maybe it landed to it landed to France. You know, the plane might be coming back again to Hamburg. I want to tell you, they have to refuel the gas. They have to refuel the gas. You know, although it has a car that can still bring it back to Hamburg after landing in France, but still they have to make sure that the tank of the fuel tank is full loaded. You know why? Because there can be a storm that it may not land, you know, when it's supposed to land. So, but if it does not have enough gas, and they said, okay, we have a half tank. Our tank is half. Now we can still use it to fly down to Hamburg. Although you can still do that, but it is always very good to have this very prevention before the kill, you know, to feel that very gap, to feel that very thank again. So this is how it is with us when we go to the mountain. We go and refresh the direction. We go and refresh the wisdom. We go and refresh the knowledge that God has given to us. You know, it's not a place to go and look for power, but it's a place just to make sure that you receive a favor and a wisdom to move forward in life. So I will entreat each and every one of you, make sure you visit any of the mountain. And if God of heaven gives us one, so we like you to be a part. If God of heaven gives us one, just be a part of that. And so we need your prayer. Let's see Psalm 121, verse 1 and 2. Psalm 121, verse 1 and 2. I want us to see that very scripture in Psalm 121, verse 1 and verse 2. Hallelujah. Now the Bible says here, I will lift up my eyes unto the hills. From hence cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord, which made heaven and earth. I want to take this very wonderful scripture once again. I will lift up my eyes unto the hills. From hence cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord, which maketh heavens and the earth. What is he talking about? The hill here represents the mountain. I will lift up my eyes unto the hills. From hence cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord. What is he trying to let us know here? When you go to the mountain, you are going there to seek the help of God. You are going there to seek the help of God because that is where your help comes from. Your help comes from the Lord. So when you go there, you are telling God that my strength is not able to move me to the next level. So I need your help to help me to move on to the next level. I believe that a lot of Christians in Europe would have accomplished a lot of things if we have got mountains. I strongly believe that, because I have been many times in the mountain, and I know before I went to the mountain how I feel, and after I come out from the mountain how I feel. Brothers and sisters, I came with the presence of God, believe me. I came with the Zui. I came with the anointing of the Holy Ghost. I came not with the enticing words of man, but with a demonstration of the Spirit of God. But it means God has brought me into another level of the healing grace. I'm telling you, healing grace. You know, when I came out from the mountain, I begin to look for those who are sick. Believe me, this very grace just came upon me. I'm telling you, you're gonna witness something, you know, in this very continent of Europe. You're gonna witness unusual miracles, not by struggle, because when you go to the mountain, God terminates your struggles. It's no more by might or neither by power, but by the presence of the Lord, by the Spirit of God. When you come to the mountain, you contact this very higher grace, and your life can never, never be the same again. Matthew 17 and verse 20. And Jesus said unto them, because of your unbelief, for verily I say unto you, if your faith as a grain of mustard seed. You know, I want to say this. Mountain is a place whereby your faith grows, whereby you grow your faith. The spirit of doubt leaves you, because you can never be in a quiet place with the presence of God, studying the word of God, memorizing the word of God, praying the word of God, and the unbelief can still rule you. It can never, never be possible. So when you have this very wonderful quiet place, you know, you'll find out that right now your faith begins to grow, your faith begins to mature, your faith begins to climb higher. So doubt begins to give way. So when you enter, except you go to the mountain without knowing the reason why you got there. But when you don't, you know the reason why you go to the mountain, that you want to table your case before God, and you begin to hear the word of God, you begin to memorize the word of God, you begin to pray the word of God. But it means faith comes by hearing, and hearing the word of God. So that's a place whereby spirit of doubt begin to check out of your life, begin to move away from you, and the spirit of boldness begin to come inside of you. That is why Elijah said, let's go to the mountain to settle this matter. The man that was running away before decided not to go to the mountain. You know, it's a place that you know that when he got there, I have a quiet time with God. Boldness to confront Ahab, boldness to confront the Jezebel will come upon him. And boldness to confront the prophets of Baal will come upon him. That is why he said, let's go to the mountain. But the prophet of Baal did not know that this very young man have decided to be in the presence of God, to seek the presence of God in order for him to overcome them. You know, when you go to the mountain, it's a place to seek the presence of God to overcome whatsoever that have been challenging you. It's a place you take dominion. It's a place you rule. It's a place you command. It's a place you build your faith to be very, very strong. So I will entreat you to get to any mountain if there is anyone in this very continent where we live. But I'm strongly believing God that He's going to give me one so that everybody can be a part of that. I want to close you tonight with this very scripture in the book of Nahum. Nahum chapter 1 and verse 15. If you want to get to the book of Nahum, it's better you start from the book of Malachi, going to the left side of your Bible. It's better you start from the book of Malachi, going to the left side of your Bible. You're going to get the book of Nahum, N-A-H-U-M, Nahum. Behold, upon the mountains, the feet of him that bringeth good tidings, that publisheth peace, O Judah, keep thy solemn feast, perform thy vows, for the wilderness shall no more pass. Praise the Lord. Shall no more pass through thee. He is utterly cut off. I want to say this very scripture again. Behold, upon the mountains, the feet of him that bringeth good tidings, that publisheth peace. O Judah, keep thy solemn feast. Keep thy solemn feast. Perform thy vows, for the wicked shall no more pass through thee. He is utterly cut off. What is this scripture trying to let us know? It's trying to let us know that mountains is a place for good news. Mountains is a place for good news. You see, this is the why the demonic people also use mountains to fight the children of God. This is why they use mountains to fight the things of God. They know that if they can be in their mountains to perform their sacrifices, they fight the children of God. But here the Bible is telling us that a mountain is a place for good news. So you can never climb mountain and come back the same, except your mind is not on the reason and the purpose why you go there. Nobody climbs a mountain and remains the same, except you did not climb in the name of the Lord. Never. Nobody climbed a mountain without having a contact with God. Nobody climbs a mountain without having a text money. Nobody climbs a mountain without having a good news. This is what the Nahum chapter 1 and verse 15 is telling us. So it does not matter. He said he's going to cut off every works of hell. He's going to cut off every cruise and the waters of the enemy. He's going to deal with the powers that does not match you to have that very inner peace. And tonight I am here to pray for you anywhere you are in all over the world. I am here to commit you into the hands of God tonight. I'm here to pray for you. As I have come down from this very great mountain, I'm going to pray for you. I'm going to speak a word concerning your needs. I'm going to speak a word concerning your challenges. I'm going to speak a word concerning anything that has been a problem in your life. Brothers and sisters, the Bible said it's not by might or not by power, but by the presence of God, by the Spirit of God. I have contacted heaven. I have contacted the grace. I have contacted this very unusual grace. And as I speak, it must surely come to pass. The Bible said in the book of Isaiah chapter 65 and verse 24, the Bible said while they are praying, God will hear. And before they finish praying, God will answer. So I just want to let you know that whatever you have been struggling to receive, we come to the doorpost. We come to your doorpost because somebody has fasted on your behalf. Somebody is calling upon God on your behalf. Somebody has called upon God in that very mountains concerning your needs. So viewers all over the world, my sons and my daughters, I have gone to the mountain because of you, and every challenge that the enemy has brought upon your life shall be terminated tonight in the mighty name of Jesus. Not by struggle, never by struggle, but by the authority that is in the word of God. I challenge your challenges tonight, and I command the fire of the Holy Ghost to deal with every evil mountain where they are calling your name in the night. Any man going naked in the night, any woman going naked in the night, calling upon your name in that mountain, I command the Holy Ghost fire to enter that very mountain tonight in the mighty name of Jesus. The Bible says something that is very profound. You know, people had a mountain and they built an altar and they were bewitching people. They were taking people's glory. They were taking people's honor. They were taking the blessings of the people. And one day, a man that called Gideon stood up and said, "Hey, man, this is your mountain where you have been sacrificing evil. This is your altars where you have been doing evil. This is your secret place where you have been doing evil. I'm going to bring it down. I'm going to burn it to ashes." And the people woke up in the morning and found out that their altar in their mountains had been burned to ashes. And they said, "My God, who did this evil? Who have done this very evil?" And they finally found out that it was Gideon. And they went to the father of Gideon and said, "Father, hey, bring out your son here. Your son have done evil." And the father said to Gideon, "What have you done?" Gideon told the people that, "I did not touch any of you. If your power, if your altar, if your mountain is stronger, Let him fight for himself. Brothers and sisters, I command every mountain and I command every altar. They are placed in any mountain or in any secret place fighting you. I command the fire of the Holy Ghost to enter into that mountain. I command the fire of the Holy Ghost to enter into that very altar. In the mighty name of Jesus, I set you free from every power of hell. I want to make a decree tonight. You know, many people are coming to our program. Many people are coming to our program that is coming up on the 27th, 28th, and the 29th of this very month. Many people are coming. Some are coming from the London, some are coming from other parts of the world, France and so on. They are coming for the baptism of immersion. When I dip you into that water, brothers and sisters, when you wake up from that very water, I tell you, that enemy will never touch you again. Because I come to realize in 1 Kings chapter 18, the Bible said that when Elijah brought the prophet of Baal to the mountain, he said, in this mountain we're going to pour water. So what am I talking about? Water in the mountain, the Bible said God descended in this very presence of God descended and was able to stand with Elijah. I have come from all the way from this very messy city with this very grace upon my life. I am going to baptize you on 27th, 28th, and 29th of this month of December. What are you waiting for? Make sure you be a part of that. And on 31st night of December, many people are already registered and they are coming. Brothers and sisters, while they are coming, come with the 3 prayer points. While they are coming, come with the 3 prayer points. Come with a little sand. Where are you from? Where you live? And also the death envelope is put a seed to thank God for crossing you over to the new year. Not everybody see this very new year. I am going to wash your feet with the oil of riches so that 2020 will be a year of testimony for you. God has given me a word concerning the year 2020. It's going to be a year of speed. You know, cheetah has got a speed. And what you could not achieve in 2019, this very 2020, my God will favor you. It's a year of greater grace. God has given me a word. It's a year of speed and the greater grace. And I tell you, as I wash your feet with this very oil of riches, oil of mercy and wonders, and the water of the pool of Bethesda, brothers and sisters, your life can never be the same again. What are you waiting for? We need you in this very city of Hamburg, so that 2020 is going to be a year for you to fly and soar on the eagle's wings. Not only that, on 25th of this very month, being a Christmas, many believers have neglected Christmas. I'm telling you, many people doesn't value Christmas anymore because the love of God in their heart has was cold. They are no more vibrant in the spirit. Nobody is vibrant in the spirit can stay at home on 25th of December. Some people celebrate on 24th of December. I don't have any problem about that. But if you are a believer, you are a child of God, you are a Christian, and you can sit at home when those that celebrate on 24th, you can sit at home on 24th, and those that celebrate on 25th, and you can sit at home on 25th, I strongly believe something definitely is wrong with you. You have forgotten somebody who saved your life. You have forgotten somebody who cried at the cross of Calvary on your behalf. You have forgotten. You cannot show appreciation to go and worship him and give him the glory for saving your life. I want to tell you, brothers and sisters, while you were sleeping on your waterbed, he was born in a manger. He was born in a manger. We played, they kept animals. That is where he was born, just because of you. And you cannot recognize him and appreciate him. So on 25th of December, we have this very free food. We have this very free drinks. We invite each and every one of you to come and dine with us. The word of God will make available. The word of God will come alive. The presence of God will make full, and the grace of God will abound to your life. So I invite each and every one of you on this very Sunday, 22nd of December. Be my guest. Be my guest. That is a family blessing. Be my guest to celebrate with me. And on 25th, I want to see you. And on 27th, 28th, and 29th, I want to see you here, because I want to baptize you. I want to dip you into water so that when you wake up, the presence of God will go with you. And on 31st night, don't forget, come with this very 3 prayer points. With 3 prayer points, put it in one envelope and put a little sand from where you live. Why the sand? Somebody may ask. The Bible said in the book of Joshua chapter 1 from verse 3. We are sorry about the soul of our fish shall drink upon. Then God will give us as an inheritance. You might know that, brothers and sisters, so that the ground will not swallow you, but the ground will favor you. Where you live will favor you. The sand represents the ground, so that the ground will not swallow you, because any place the soul of your feet shall tread upon, God is going to give you peace. I want to announce to you, so that nobody will deport you. So we want the soul of your feet to be established in the land, according to the word of God. So I want each and every one of you to be my guest on 31st night, 8 o'clock in the night. We have already started to move this very work forward. So we have this very wonderful guest house. It's not too expensive. We want each and every one of you to be a part, so that it's the same compound of the church, so that you can be able to experience this very kind of the mountain experience. You can prostrate in the presence of God in the church auditorium just to have one-on-one with God. What are you waiting for? I want to let each and every one of you to know, I came with this very fire, and I want to transfer that fire upon your life. I want to impart the spiritual grace upon your life. I want to make sure that you defeat anything that I've been defeating you, that the chains of the enemy concerning your life shall be broken, that the weapons of hell shall be turned back to sender, that the man that have condemned you shall be condemned forever. I want to announce to you, after I lay my hands upon you, your life can only move forward. God richly bless you for tuning in tonight. You will never go down again, in the name of Jesus. See you on Sunday, 22nd of December, and my God is going to favor you on every side, in the name of Jesus. Once again, here is your prophet, Prophet Julius Obiagono. We just want to say thank you for watching, and may God fight your battle from today. And before the end of this year, may your miracle be on your hands, in the name of Jesus. Thank you for watching, and see you on Sunday, in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. God bless you.
Amen.
God bless you. Hallelujah.